Yeah, hello everybody. I think a number of you are still trying to register for labs. Is that correct? Who still needs to get into a lab section? Oh, okay, not that many then. Anyway, if you still need to get into a lab section, either come and see me after the lecture is over. Who has a class right after this one? Okay, so if you do have a class right after this one, then you can just email me if you still need to get into a lab section. Make sure you tell me which section you want to get into. But I guess most of you don't have a class after this, which is good. Okay, I think about half of you, maybe? Who took 211 from me? Oh yeah, about half of you. Okay, so this is a first for me in that I'm teaching the class that requires another course that I taught as a prerequisite. So if you don't know your 211 stuff, then I'll say, who taught you 211? Okay, let me switch back. So one of the things that I'm doing for this course, if you have not taken a course from me, or if you have, some of my stuff has changed. So those of you who took 211 from me, that was the kind of the first time I started recording lectures as I gave them and putting them on YouTube. So I'm going to do the same thing with this course. That doesn't mean you shouldn't come to class. It's if you miss something or you just want to review something that I talked about. So I'm using this, what you see here, this piece of recording software, because it's free. And it's just the screen capture software, because what I'm also going to be doing, which is new, for those of you who had me for 211 before, is I have this computer where I can write stuff on the slides, so it makes my PowerPoints can be a little bit more interactive. Anyway, so I need to record the screen to do that. Now, that screen recording software, I've tried this one and a couple of other free ones. There seems to be some kind of syncing issue with the screen resolution of when I connect my computer to an external source, like this projector. So when you look at the videos on YouTube, my pointer, my mouse pointer, which you can see moving around here, won't actually correspond to where it is on the slide. In other words, if I was to point at syllabus right now, when you look at the YouTube recording of this that I will post, my pointer would be pointing somewhere else because of a screen resolution issue. So if someone can figure out how to get around this, so my videos will look nicer, then maybe I'll give some bonus points. I normally don't give bonus points for anything, but maybe I'll make an exception. If not, anyway, the lectures online are meant to be a backup, not your sole source of your information for this course. Something's screwing up here. Let me get out of PowerPoint. Okay. Okay, so this is the syllabus for the course. It's online on the Lalima site. If you downloaded it a couple of days ago, I might have changed it since then. So if you look at the bottom of the syllabus, it tells you what revision we're on. I'm on revision 1. I had uploaded revision 0 earlier, so make sure you have the updated one. The revisions really are only, I'm changing around the schedules and stuff. I'm not going to change the grading policy, so that's going to stay in place. What we're going to be learning in this course is we're going to be learning about diodes, amplifiers, and transistors in this course. So this is, if you don't like circuits, this is the last circuits course you need to take. If you do like circuits, then this is the first interesting circuits course that you're going to take. Because you can't make that many circuits with just resistors, capacitors, and inductors. But you can make a lot more cool stuff once you add transistors to the circuits. But anyway, even if this is the last circuits course you're going to take, it's very important to know the idea of transistors and how transistors work. Because almost any electrical device or electronic device is going to contain a transistor in it. The grading policy for this course, we'll have roughly a homework per week, a little bit less than that. That's 10% of the course grade. I don't accept late homework, but I do allow you to drop one of the homework grades. We have a grader for this course, and the way that the homework is going to be graded, because there's so many students in this course, and because the department budget isn't that high, so go tell your legislator to give UH more money, because that's where it all stems from. But anyway, because the department budget can't support the grader for probably as many hours as it would take to grade all of your homework assignments, most of the problems are going to be just graded on if you did it or not. So you're just going to get checked off. And a couple of the problems will be graded to check your steps and your process. So even if you didn't get the right answer, you can get some partial credit on the process. But anyway, as a result of that, your homework grades are probably going to tend to be higher than if we checked every single problem. Because on the ones where we're just checking if you did it or not, you know, maybe you skipped some steps or something like that and somehow ended up at the right answer, but you still get the credit for it. So it's important that after the homework solutions are posted and after you get your graded homework back, that you go back and check and reconcile between the two, because you might have gotten full credit on one of the problems, but you still messed up something. So make sure to do that. And I'm not going to tell you ahead of time which problems are the ones that are graded based on partial credit. So you should do all of the problems. We'll have two exams for this course. These are the exam dates, I think. Hang on, I'm going to change those. Okay, those are not the exam dates. I changed those. Don't go by these exam dates. I have a schedule after this, and I'll go by those exam dates. So that means that this syllabus is already out of date. There will be revision 2 of this syllabus posted to LaLima later today. But anyway, there'll be two exams in class and then final, and then that final time is not going to change. So on the second page of the syllabus, you will see the approximate schedule for this course, when the homework assignments are due, but that's really approximate. So once I actually assign the homework, each homework assignment will have a due date on that, and just go by that instead of looking at this. And the exam dates on this schedule are the ones that I'm going to go with. So the first exam will be February 20th. The second exam will be April 15th. And you can go look through the rest of this on your own. Most of you are also taking the lab with this course. So there's four sections of the lab. These are the lab TAs. So if you're in Section 1, you'll have Andy Pham. Section 2 will have Bryson Leong. If you're in Section 3, that'll be Alex Lee. And then Section 4, Ashkar Rahman. He goes by Ashik, but he'll tell you that once you meet him. Now, there's no labs for the next couple of weeks. Okay, so this week and next week, there aren't going to be any labs. Yes. Yeah, that's Section 4. Okay, but once again, no labs this week. Don't show up to lab later today or later on in the week. And next week also, no labs. But we'll have labs after that. There used to be a lab manual that was a companion to your textbook, but it wasn't very good. So what we're doing this semester is we created our own labs. So that's what you'll be working on. And we'll be posting the lab manuals as time goes on. Now for the labs, your TAs will also go over this in the lab sections, but you'll be doing pre-lab exercises that are about 25% or are 25% of the total grade. Your lab reports will be 50% of your total lab grade. Just showing up gets you 10%. And there's 15% of a new category, which is something called practical skills. And this category is driven from feedback that I've had from people at companies that hire our students. So one criticism that I've heard of our students that go and work at companies is, at least at the beginning, they tend to burn out a lot of things. And you might be familiar with that from like 2.11 and 2.13 lab, especially, you know, in those labs, if you dealt with op amps or something like that, you might have burnt out a few of them. Now, that's fine, sort of fine when you're a student. It is costing you money because your professional fees is what's paying for all of these parts. So if we need more and more parts, that means more and more of your fees are just going to buying parts instead of upgrading things. But in once you go to a company, it's going to become less and less acceptable to keep burning out things. And that's for a couple of reasons. So one of them could be the cost. Okay, so if your company has just spent 6 months working on your newest and greatest prototype, and that's going to make your company $1 million, and you short circuit it and the whole thing melts, then that's, you know, a significant amount of cost there to the company, and then you probably just lost your job. But it's not only just cost, because if you look at, say, op amps, you say, okay, well, I don't care if I burn those out because they're less than $1 per op amp. They're not really that expensive. And that might be true for other components that you work with, but you also have to take into account time that you lose besides just the price of the item. So, for example, one specific example that I was given from these people that are talking to me about the graduates that they've hired is that they had some components that weren't really that expensive, but they had to come in from the mainland. And so if you don't have any, it takes you 6 weeks to get some more. And I think they didn't tell a student that, so they burnt out all their components, which didn't cost that much money, but it cost a lot of time in order to bring in some more. And so all of these careless mistakes are what we're trying to make you not do at all. And so that's going to be this 15% for the practical skills in lab. So how are you going to test that? Well, we're going to give you a set amount of components in the beginning of the lab. And so let's say you're doing an op amp lab. So we give you an op amp, you go and do the lab. If you come back for a second op-amp, that might affect the grade. It depends on what actually happened. So it's sort of a case-by-case thing, but that can affect your grade. If you come back for a third one and a fourth one, that will affect that part of the grade more and more. So you really should get in the habit of double-checking, triple-checking your circuits before you apply power to them. Doing the same thing, whenever you're going to change a circuit, disconnect the power, double-check it, triple-check it again before you put power back onto it. Make sure that your cords and everything are set up in such a way that you can't accidentally short circuit, stuff like that. All of that is very good lab practice, and that's going to be reflected in that practical skills part of the grade. Okay, any questions on that? So this is the lab schedule. There might be some changes to the schedule, but at least not for the first few weeks. Okay, so this week and next week, there will be no labs. And starting the week of the 26th will be the first lab. For the pre-labs, make sure you get the pre-labs done before you go to class. The general theme is going to be that you're going to design some circuit in the pre-lab, simulate it. That's all done before lab, and then you're going to come to lab and build that circuit and measure that circuit. So if you don't do the pre-lab, then you can't do the lab. And so you're just going to, you know, fall further and further behind. So make sure you do the pre-labs before you go to lab. Okay. The class website is going to be the LaLima site. Everyone is familiar with that. If you don't know what I'm talking about, then come and see me. And all of the stuff that I'm talking about here will be posted to LaLima, or is already there. The lecture notes for today is already on LaLima. The syllabus I need to update now. And homework assignments will also go there. If I need to make any announcements, they'll come out through the email tool of LaLima, which sends stuff to your hawaii.edu account. So make sure you check that account. For the homework, it's about an assignment per week, and you can drop a grade. Also, if you have something wrong with the grading of your homework, then you have a week to tell me about that. What you're going to do is you're not going to touch anything on your original homework, but you're going to submit a separate paper that just says what's wrong with it. Like, the points are added up wrong on problem number 4, or I wrote this equation on problem number 5, but I didn't get credit for it, that kind of thing. I already talked about this for the labs. Okay, so let's talk about what we're going to cover in this course. And the way I like to explain that, and those of you who have taken a class have probably already seen this, is we look at a good electrical engineering project, also mechanical engineering as well. Any mechanical engineers in here? No? Okay, well, that's not important then. And if we look at this smartphone, what kinds of subsystems or what kinds of components do we have here? Power system? That's it? Communication sensors. What kind of sensors does a smartphone have? Okay, touch screen. I'm not not going to include microphone and sensor, but maybe that can be part of the communication system. Gyroscope, yes. Most phones don't actually have a gyroscope, I think. But they do have accelerometers. The gyroscope is a more complicated version. So this one is cheaper. I think most phones have accelerometers. Anything else? CPU. Okay, that's a pretty good list, maybe. Maybe let's break it down further then. So what else would fall under the communication system? What makes the phone part of it? What kind of components would you have there? An antenna, yeah. Oops. Speaker. Let's put that under sensors, maybe. Oh, what? USB port. That's sort of maybe interfaces. Amplifiers. Where would be the amplifiers? What would you use an amplifier for? Okay, so the communication system needs amplifiers. The speaker also needs an amplifier. So there's multiple kinds of amplifiers inside your smartphone. Okay, so this is how I broke it up, and it's according to the EE curriculum. Okay, so you have resistors, capacitors, and inductors in there. You already know that. For the communication side, I'm calling this RF, or radio frequency. So you have your antenna in there, filters so that you can select certain frequencies that you're going to communicate at or receive, oscillators, which that's actually creating the signal, the sinusoidal signal, and then all those kinds of components fall under the transmitter and receiver side. And these are covered by the electromagnetics courses in the curriculum, 371, 473, 474. Software side is covered by these computer engineering courses. The central processing unit, or CPU, again is covered by some computer engineering courses. There aren't physical pieces in here that use signals and communications, but if you want to analyze the signals that are coming in and out of your smartphone, how do you put data on it, how do you model them, that's going to be the systems series of courses. This is not 341, this is 343. And then those amplifiers that we talked about, some of them are part of the transmitter and receiver. You would have a power amplifier to your speakers on the phone. Memory inside your phone, solid state memory, switches, not mechanical switches, but electronic switches. Those things fall under these EP courses. So 323, we're going to cover some of that. 326, we'll cover some more of that. And then the semiconductor physics courses and the microfabrication course also covers all of that. And for the camera, those are usually CMOS cameras, and you learn a little bit about that in 327. And the optics part of the camera in 372. And accelerometers, those are microfabricated devices that aren't really covered in your undergraduate courses, but they are covered in a graduate course. And then, not part of the phone, but eventually you need to charge your phone. And being able to convert the AC electricity at the wall into the DC electricity needed by the phone is something that you can do with diodes. So that's covered in this course. And then there's the battery, which is an important part of it, but usually it's more chemical engineering. So if your batteries don't last that long, then blame some chemical engineers. Okay, so again, these are the important things that we care about of the phone for this course. Some of them you've already covered in other courses, and then these are the kinds of things that we're going to cover in this course. Okay, so this is, again, a outline of the topics that we're going to go through. So we're first going to learn about diodes, and an application of diodes is to rectify a signal or convert it from an AC signal to a DC signal, and that's how your phone, when you plug it into the wall, that's how the AC electricity from the wall gets converted into DC for your phone. You can also use diodes to do voltage regulation as well, so we'll talk about it in terms of those power circuits, those charging circuits. We're then going to cover amplifiers. And these can be like audio amplifiers for the speakers, or those amplifiers in the wireless communication part of the cell phone. And we'll talk about different kinds of amplifiers in this class. We'll talk about amplifiers in general, and then we'll talk about making amplifiers out of op-amps, making amplifiers out of MOSFETs and BJTs. MOSFETs and BJTs, you don't know what they stand for yet. But the T stands for transistor. So these are transistors. And then the electronic switches that I mentioned, those are used in CPUs and in solid state memory. Those are also implemented using transistors. So we'll learn about using transistors both as amplifiers and as switches. Okay, so that's the end of that part of the lecture. And we'll go right into learning about diodes. Who in this class has already taken EE324? Oh. A pretty good number. So everyone else has not taken it? Okay, so some of this beginning part will be a review for those of you who have taken 324. If you haven't taken 324, then this will be new information. It might be a little overwhelming in the beginning because I'm giving you probably 2 months of 324 in the next 20 minutes. But don't worry, it's just to let you build up to the point where you know how we're getting the equations that describe the diode behavior. So if you forget, or if you don't understand what I'm talking about, maybe if you only understand like maybe 50%, that should be enough. Okay, so first of all, let's go over why we are going to learn about diodes. And so if you look at these various circuits, so an AC to DC adapter, voltage regulator, or a logic gate, all of these types of circuits can be made using diodes. One thing I should note to you here, so the notes that I have on Laulima, everything that's on these slides are in the notes. So if I write something down on these slides, that means it's not in the notes. So make sure you write it down too. And you also can review the lecture recording too if you miss anything. Okay, so all of these circuits can be realized using diodes. So that's why we want to understand what diodes are and how they work. So what is a diode? Well, the basic definition of a diode would be something that regulates the flow of current. So it will allow current to pass through it in one direction, but it won't allow current to pass through it in the other direction. And there's different ways in which you can make a diode, but the first diode type that we're going to learn is something called a PN junction diode. Okay, and why are we going to learn this particular type of diode at the beginning? Well, you have PN junctions in a lot of semiconductor devices. So this picture on the left shows a circuit schematic for a diode, and the diode is made out of one PN junction. This circuit symbol in the middle is a bipolar junction transistor, or BJT, and that's made out of two PN junctions. This circuit symbol on the right is a metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, or MOSFET. And this one is also made out of two PN junctions. Okay, so the PN junction is an important part of all these different types of semiconductor devices. So diodes, I already said what we can use them for. These transistors, we can use them as amplifiers and the switches. Okay, so let's go over what a PN junction actually is. Okay, so the PN junction, there's two parts. There's a P part and an N part. And the P part is a P-type semiconductor. The N part is an N-type semiconductor. And this, if I put the N and P type semiconductor against each other, that forms a diode. And this is that circuit symbol from before. This right side is the anode, this left side is the cathode of the diode. Okay, so we know that the diode, if it's a PN junction diode, is made out of N and P type semiconductor. But what does that mean? Okay, so let's define a semiconductor, but let's do that in terms of the types of electronic properties of materials. So what are the three types of electrical materials? If I'm going to classify a material according to its electrical properties, so I heard insulator. Insulator is one. So what's the electrical properties of an insulator? So an insulator doesn't let current flow through it. So what can I say about the electrical resistance of an insulator? So this resistance should be very high. Okay, what's the opposite of an insulator? Conductor. And so since it's the opposite, so in this case, current will easily flow through a conductor. So So the resistance of a conductor is very low. What's an example of a conductor? Copper wire? Yeah, copper wire. Copper is a conductor. What's an example of an insulator? Rubber. Okay. And then between the two, between an insulator and a conductor, is a semiconductor. Okay, so what's the electrical property of a semiconductor? So you can get current to go through a semiconductor, but the important feature of the semiconductor is that you can control the current flow. Oops. And control. So you can control the flow of current through the semiconductor. What's an example of a semiconductor? Silicon's a semiconductor. Anything else? Gallium arsenide. Anything else? Germanium is also a semiconductor. There's a lot of other compounds in the group 3 and the group 5 groups of the periodic table. If we combine those are semiconductors. And you can get more complicated combinations too, like indium, gallium, arsenide, phosphide, and so forth. Anyway, those are all kinds of materials that will allow you to control the current that's through that going through that material. Okay, so we know what a semiconductor is now. So what's the N and P type? So the N and P type means that the semiconductor has some doping to that. And what do we mean by that? Well, let's first understand what silicon looks like just by itself, okay? So we'll take a semiconductor, which is silicon, and in the periodic table, it's group 4, so it has 4 valence electrons. So if you put silicon atoms together, they're going to form a structure like this, where they're sharing electrons in order to fill up that outermost electron shell. And that's what happened. This is what silicon looks like at near absolute zero. So very stable. Once you increase the temperature, so this is what silicon looks like near room temperature. You have enough thermal energy there that some of those electrons are actually gonna not participate in that bonding. They're gonna have enough thermal energy that they're just free and they're just roaming around that silicon lattice. And if that electron is free and it's not associated with a particular silicon atom, that means that in one of those bonds, we have a place where that electron kind of isn't there anymore. So we call that absence of an electron a hole. It's not really a particle, but you can kind of think about it like a particle. And it will have a positive charge, so that's an absence of where that electron used to be. So if you take out an electron from that lattice, you leave behind a hole. Okay, and if we have these free electrons moving around, then it's very easy to transfer charges between the different atoms. So the amount of current that you can get to flow through this semiconductor depends upon how many of these free electrons that you have. That's how we can control the current through this semiconductor. The more free electrons we have, the more current is going to flow through this semiconductor. So what we want to do if we want to have a lot of control over the current, is we want to control how many of these free electrons are moving around in the lattice. But first, we need to describe that. So for intrinsic silicon, we didn't do anything to silicon. It's just a bunch of silicon atoms stuck together. We can define a density of free electrons and a density of free holes. And because the holes are created once an electron frees itself, they have to be equal to each other. Okay, so the density of free electrons, which is n, is going to be equal to the density of free holes. And we're going to make that equal to a variable called n sub I, which is the density of free electrons or holes in an intrinsic semiconductor. And in order to figure this out, we can use this equation here, which depends a lot on temperature. I have a temperature cubed component in this equation, and another temperature term in this exponential. So the number of free electrons and free holes depends entirely upon the, or it depends a lot upon the temperature that I have this semiconductor at. So I can, if you wanted to, you could control current flow through a semiconductor by changing its temperature. But that's going to be relatively slow because you got to heat it up and then wait for it to cool down. So another way to change how much current can flow through the semiconductor is to just adjust these densities, to adjust the density of free electrons and adjust the density of free holes. And we do that with something called doping. Okay, so in doping, what we do is we take that silicon semiconductor, and instead of some of those silicon atoms, we replace that with a different type of atom. So in this case, if we replace it with phosphorus, phosphorus has an extra valence electron. So it's going to bond to four neighboring silicon atoms, but it'll still have an extra valence electron left over. And so that will contribute to the amount of free electrons that we have there. And that's something called a donor. It's donating an electron to this semiconductor. And because I now have an excess of electrons in the semiconductor, the density of electrons was given by the variable n. So since I now have more electrons, I call this an n-type semiconductor. So in an n-type semiconductor, it just means that the charge carriers, the majority of the charge carriers, are going to be free electrons. So when your current is going through your n-type semiconductor, it's mostly being carried by that charge transfer from the free electrons. You can also do the opposite thing. If I took that silicon lattice and instead of adding an element that had an extra electron, I added an element that had one less electron. Okay, so that's like saying I have an extra hole in my silicon crystal. And so that's a place where an electron wants to go to. So, or you can think about it like a particle. So I have this extra positive particle that can move around my semiconductor lattice. And that can also transfer charge so I can conduct current. Okay, so this is called a p-type semiconductor because I have more holes there than I have electrons. And it's the opposite case of the n-type. Now I'm conducting current by the movement, mostly by the movement of these holes in the semiconductor. Okay, this is just saying in equations what I just said in words. So the carrier concentrations that I talked about before, that N and P, now we can write new carrier concentrations that have a subscript N naught This is just to indicate that it's doped. And that's going to be about equal to the concentration of those donor atoms or acceptor atoms that I added. So if we go back to our PN junction, so we know that one side of the junction is doped so that it has more free electrons. The other side, this whole thing is silicon, but the other side is you added some atoms so that there's more holes there. And so I have one type of semiconductor here, but I have more electrons, free electrons in one side, and more holes in the other side. And this structure magically makes it so that current is only going to flow through this structure in one direction, or mostly in one direction. And that's indicated by this circuit symbol here. Okay, so your circuit symbol for the diode looks like an arrow. So here's the arrow. And so that means if I apply voltage with this orientation to the diode, your current wants to go that way. So the arrow of this current matches sort of the arrow of the diode. And so the diode will allow current to flow this way, from the anode to the cathode. If I apply the voltage in the opposite polarity, so that if I did this one down here, this current is going to be very, very small. So pretty much zero. So that wouldn't have current in that orientation. And that's what this PN junction structure allows you to do. Okay, now to understand why that's happening, we have to look at the PN junction once again. But I think I'll leave that for the next class. Okay, so again, if you are trying to get into a lab, but you haven't yet, then come and see me.